We found out the hard way we can't use this material, 3D printed resin, to be used in liquid silicone rubber injection moulds. The main reason for that is the conductivity of the material is so low that the temperature wasn't getting from the heater probe through to the thermocouple. It was warm here where we used it, but it was cold over here. For liquid silicone rubber to set the mould around, it needs to be about 180 degrees. Even if we could get the heat through the mould, the cycle times would be really, really low because we would be taking heat out of the mould as we inject the material. Then the mould would have to reheat up and the cycle times may be unusable. It was getting hot here, but not even conducting all the way through the back here. So even if we had the heater probe in here, we wouldn't be able to get the conductivity through up through the material to the face that needs it. There are some really nice materials we can use to do this sort of stuff, but it's a bit more exotic than we want to do. We're happy to go back to our aluminium moulds. Aluminium's got an extremely high conductivity, yep. So it's perfect for this.
For memory, to get the aluminium to 180 only took less than 10 minutes.
So this is the silicone flap here. USB-C port and a SD card slot sits there. The SD card sticks out of the SD card connector and actually sits into this flap. So we've employed components on the circuit board to help hold the flap in. This one has a lip that's actually on the inside of this face here. The pin goes in and basically gets held in. It's got a seal around the pin. This part of the pin, which is a flange, basically gets held on the inside surface of this face. And the same thing with these flanges here. That's going to hold it in. The problem with that is that you can't actually machine this and it becomes quite a complex little mould. The 3D printing should have allowed us to basically make these undercuts directly in the 3D printed mould, but the conductivity is just not where we need it to be. This is the mould that we've been looking at. We got some really good feedback from some LinkedIn members who are in injection moulding who gave us some feedback on the runner design, which was awesome. So thanks very much for that, guys. We've gone ahead and tried to make this in a way that we can manufacture using CNC machining. We're trying to machine this from five sides using the five axis. The features are on this side. We can come in and machine on the back here, and we can actually make that step here for one side of the flanges which hold it into the housing. The other side of the flanges have to be made with some sort of pin. So we've come up with a design here, which is a precision CNC pin inside a pin. So this pin here makes sort of the tongue that would replicate where the circuit board is. And this one here is replicating the feature of the SD card where the flap will actually hold onto. This pin here is actually a relief for the pin that holds it in. It allows us to actually squish the material, get it through into the housing, and it'll then pop out and hold into place. CAD is always deceiving. This thing here is only about 25 mil long. This pin in here is about 9 mil. And this funky feature on the side is actually because it comes through on an angle. That pin there is on a slight angle. So there's a draft angle on here because we designed this so it can be injection molded. We're currently CNCing them on the five axis, which gives us the ability to easily put that draft angle on. So this feature that is going to be the negative of this has to come down at the 3 degree draft angle. Let's come up with this design here, which was an improvement on my design. We're putting this pocket on an angle to give us the bottom of the pocket, so to speak, a flat surface where the liquid silicone rubber will actually sit onto. I think people are going to ask, why didn't we 3D print this out of metal 3D printing? It's because the surface finish will not be what we want it to be, especially in those undercuts and especially with liquid silicone rubber. A rough surface finish will not allow it to probably release from the mould correctly, and from what we can see, probably not be able to get the resolution that we need to the tenth of a millimetre or less that we really need in some of these small pockets. Hearst created a drawing that gives us the dimensional tolerances that are important for fitting all this stuff together. We'll CNC as close as we can to these tolerances, but we may have to hand finish using files or polishing, things like that, to be able to get everything to slide together and move together properly. The collaboration between the toolmaker and the engineer, we've really tried to expedite that process and have a really nice, easy communication between the team, and the feedback from Antonio is invaluable to basically being able to make the part. So what are you doing now, Antonio?
Actually, I'm trying to set up the smallest part. I need to modify the holder because it seems like it doesn't do its job yet.
Making some soft jaws.
Yes, the soft jaws. This is a lot of angle to do swarf milling.
Yes.
Your favorite machining process.
That's our store. Gonna become that.
It's still big.
With this new process of toolmaking, where you basically take the CAD directly from SOLIDWORKS and put it into Mastercam, What are you looking for when you have a drawing or extra information you need rather than just the Mastercam?
Having the actual drawing itself really makes a lot of difference because you can see what's the control points, what's the sizes you need to control. You can determine easily what sort of cutting tools you're going to use. For example, with this one, it's about 0.61 millimeter on width, so we can't use really big tool on it.
Yeah, yeah.
By seeing it, I'm just going to use diameter 2 millimeter for it. It helps a lot. And also, if in the drawing state, the dimensions, you can easily see how big will be the corner radius and what sort of tools need to be used as well. The bigger, the better.
Yeah.
The radius, always the bigger, the better.
We're learning that, the hard way. We have had 1 and 2 mil radiuses in everything before now, which looks nice in CAD and all that sort of stuff, but it's a pain in the butt to machine in reality.
You actually made a good point before, adding an extra like 0.2 internal corner radiuses for the tool pass, right?
Yep.
Could you just explain just really quickly how you meant by that?
Because example on this, it's exactly 2 mil, so most likely we're gonna use a diameter 4 mil for it. The tool will just go straight on the corner. Like that and that and that and that.
Yeah.
But if you make it a little bit bigger, the tool will just go in this
nice
direction, continuous path. So let's avoid tool breakage, chatter mark.
And you've got all the tolerances here highlighted. Perth, you've specified a transitional fit. So we should be able to put these things together with minimal effort, maybe a small amount of heating or cooling on one part. We're thinking that we might epoxy or compound these together with a high temperature compound. But how close can our DMG Mori machine get to these tolerances, and how much extra finishing work we'll need to do by hand, do you think?
The tolerances is achievable, it's no problem with it. There's some variables still, corner rate, sharpness, finish, it's contribute on how you fit it. You need to polish surfaces and all this stuff. Most likely all the chemicals will go inside this thing and will make it really hard to pull it out.
Yeah, so liquid silicone rubber, one of the major challenges is that the viscosity is so low that it will flow into every crevice that it possibly can.
Exactly.
So the tools we're making out of 6061 aluminium, but we don't know what the life is going to be yet. We're looking for hundreds and low thousands of parts from this mould. That's the volumes that we're basically looking at for the Cranio Pro initial systems that are going to be deployed in the field. But giving ourselves the best chance, if we were to put a threaded pocket in the back there that we can pull out, then that's great. We'll give it a go.
So this is the smallest part of the mold. To make the part, we need to use the Swarf milling function of Mastercam.
My favorite function.
Yeah, your favorite function. So it's tilted at 1 degree. So
1 degree? Oh, it's a really odd angle, isn't it?
I used a 2 mil cutter to cut that profile. This is the whole process, if you look at it.
What size mil is this? It's like a 4 mil.
First one was 10 mil.
10 mil.
To wrap it up. And then use 2 mil, cut the whole thing. You need to tilt on a 2 degrees angle, that surface. And then you need to swarf milling the wall with this, with 1 degree angle, which is...
We're sorry, but we thank you.
Yeah.
Used to be a micro machinist though.
Yes, yes.
This is not quite micro machining.
But I haven't encountered this kind of type.
So any other challenges with this mold, you think?
This.
The slot on the angle. Yeah, that was basically the top of the finished face that comes down from the silicon part that had to be basically flat.
Yeah.
That we couldn't actually get into the mold to angle finish that pocket. We've come through on the angle there to finish that face. The pocket comes through basically straight so that we can then put our pin in that then creates the geometry that we want.
Exactly, and now we solved it. Yeah.
That was a three-man job.
It is.
We're trying to achieve an IP67 rating as minimum on this. There's two or three seal lips in this. So if that one seal lip is a square profile instead of a round profile, we'll test it and then we'll test it in the IP rating chamber anyway.
It'll be on an angle, but because it's 0.25, it's almost nothing.
You can see them on the LSR moulds though.
They
are significant. But yeah, we got to test it.
Yeah.
We can only machine what we can machine.
These are the G codes after post-processing from Mastercam. It's a different format because there's different controllers. There's Fanuc, there's Massatrol. Kuma is different as well. I then had the same way of doing it. In Fanuc, it's just only G01, G02, and X and Y. Now, in Heidenheim, you can see the difference if they put L on it.
So there's a linear cut between, say, from that X point and Y point to that X point and Y point.
Yes, it's a linear cut. If cutting circular cut, it will tell you counterclockwise something, CC.
Can you simulate this in your head when you read it, like the Matrix?
it's too small to do.
But, yeah. Thousands.
Yeah, I know.
The program was based on absolute programming. Started from a 1-0 point, yeah. Which is usually the way it should be, because you don't change your reference point, which is the safest way to do it. The more changes you make, the more mistakes you can make.
So what are you looking for here when you're scrolling through the final G-code?
So machinist, if you made the program, you know where it should be going. So when you run the machine, you see it's going on the wrong way. So you look in the G-codes and look the specific starting position, whether it's correspond with the machine and the program. If it's saying it should be going there, and yeah. You confirm it's on the right direction, where it should be starting, what coordinate the machine is using, that's the Mastercam process.
That thing there is only 0.6 of a millimeter. That there is that there. That's one thing that's always misleading with CAD, is the size of things.
Yeah. You think it's huger, then you're like, oh crap.
Yeah. I find with making some of these parts, you know, IoT things, in CAD you're like, oh, that's reasonably sized, but it's tiny. Yep. The same thing when you're making truck trays or buckets, you know, like, oh, that looks cute, yep. But it's monster. Let's do some machining.